بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. الصحابة رضي الله عنهم من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه. From the believers there are men who are truthful to their covenant. This is another episode from the Sahaba. And the Sahabi that we'll be discussing tonight, inshallah, Muhammad ibn Maslama, radiallahu anhu wa ardah. Muhammad ibn Maslama, in terms of his name, is Muhammad ibn Maslama ibn Khalid ibn Adi. And he is Aus, from the Aus. As we know, the Aus are one of the tribes of the Ansar. And he was born before the revelation by 22 years. And he was one of the people who was called in the Jahiliyyah Muhammad. So his name is Muhammad. And his kunya was Abu Abdullah, and it was said as well Abu Abdurrahman. And his Abu Abdurrahman is more authentic than Abu Abdullah. He had narrated a number of ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was said that he was, as we're going to discuss inshallah, that he was killed, and he was killed by the people of Bilad al-Sham. He, being given a sword by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had fought the mushrikeen with it, and he said to him, fight the kuffar with it, and if you find my ummah are killing each other, then hit that sword until you break it. And that is what he has done, because in the time of the fitna, Muhammad ibn Maslama did not get involved. So the Prophet of Allah gave him a sword, and he said to him, fight the mushrikeen with that sword. If you've seen my ummah fighting with each other, then do not do, first of all, break your sword, and number two, also sit at home until you have a fatal blow. That means somebody would kill you. Somebody, that means you don't really get involved. If the fitna took place, if somebody killed you, and he was within killed, as I said, by the people of Bilad al-Sham. We're going to see that he did not get involved in the fitna of Safin or Al-Jaman. He had embraced Islam very early, at the hands of Mus'ab ibn Umayr. Remember the Prophet of Allah, he sent Mus'ab ibn Umayr in order. He sent Mus'ab ibn Umayr to the Medina, and in 1 year, remember, he turned most of the Ahl Medina into Islam. One of them is Muhammad ibn Maslam. His brother, in the time of the Brotherhood, was Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah. So, Muhammad ibn Maslama, he was the brother of Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah, radiallahu anhu. He had witnessed all the gathering of the fights, the events of the Prophet ﷺ. He missed, of course, Al-Aqaba. He witnessed Badr, and he witnessed the Battle of Uhud and all of those, except for one battle, that is the Battle of Tabuk. For verily, he was left behind by the permission of the Prophet ﷺ, that is to stay in the Medina. He was from the greatest companion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had left him in the Medina in number of his expeditions, and he's, as I said, from the ones who did not participate in the fitna of the Jamal and the Safin. The Jamal between Aisha radiallahu anha, Az-Zubayr and Talha on one side, and Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the other one between Ali ibn Abi Talib on one side and Muawiyah ibn Sufyan on another side. And Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, he says regarding him, I don't know anybody, or I know that there's a person whom is not going to be affected by the fitna. And that is, he mentioned, Muhammad ibn Maslama. Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he used to employ him in those delicate matters. In case, for example, Umar al-Khattab wants to know the situation in one of his provinces, he would send Muhammad ibn Maslama. in order to expose the situation and bring their correct information from the provinces. There are many narrations which are not authentic regarding, for example, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas building a palace and all of that. But we know an incident that took place, which we have explained in this class when we talked about the biography of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, when some of the people in Al-Kufa in Iraq, they have complained about the prayer of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. So Umar al-Khattab, he was the Khalifa at that time, so he sent Muhammad ibn Maslama radiallahu anhu to investigate and to see whether the people are saying what they're saying is correct or not. So when he went, Muhammad ibn Maslama, and also Umar al-Khattab at that time, he had appointed Ammar ibn Yasir instead of Sa'd ibn Waqqas until he wanted to see the result of the investigation. So one of these complaints about Sa'd was that he does not pray properly. So when Umar al-Khattab asked him, and his kunya is Abu Ishaq, he said to him, do you pray like the people say that you don't really make a complete prayer? He said, verily I pray the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For verily I pray the Isha, I make the first two rak'ah is to be longer than the last two rak'ah. He said, that's what I think about you, O Abu Ishaq. I mean, this is what I believe about you. And that is when he had to send Muhammad ibn Maslama to investigate. So he asked all the masajid, and all the masajid, they used to praise Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, except for one masjid, which belongs to the tribe of Banu Abs. A man amongst those people called Usama ibn Qatada, and his kunya was Abu Sa'dah. He said, verily, if you have asked us and beseeched us and asked us to truly speak about Sa'd, then I'll tell you that Sa'd, he does not lead the expedition, nor he divide in justice between us, and he does not as well rule in justice. So Sa'd ibn Waqqas, upon hearing this, he said, verily, I'm going to call Allah up, you know, upon him or against him with three things. O Lord, if this slave of yours is a liar, he has just stood up to show off and to make people to know about him, then O Lord, expand his age. You know, some people say shorten his age. Well, no, prolong his age. And prolong his poverty, and on top of that, expose him to the fitan. Now, the narrator of the hadith, he said, verily, I have seen this man whom Sa'd ibn Waqqas, he made a supplication against, really getting so old to the extent that his eyebrows was falling on top of his eyes, sign of age. And he was actually in the streets, on the path, he was trying to talk to the ladies. SubhanAllah. Fitna. And he's trying to, you know, chat with them. And when he was asked about this, how can you do such a thing, an old man? He said, verily, I have been struck by the supplication of Sa'd. So we tell the brothers that the dhulm is haram. And the hadith of Abu Idris al-Khawlani, which we have narrated before, the hadith of Abu Dharr, remember? The hadith of Bilal al-Sham. Imam Ahmad said, this is the greatest, most noble hadith of Bilal al-Sham. That is the hadith of Abi Dharr, and all the narrators are from Bilal al-Sham. Abu Idris al-Khawlani, one of them. And every time Abu Idris al-Khawlani narrates a hadith from Abu Dharr, he goes on his knees. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah said, Ya ibadi, O my slave, inni haramtu dhulma ala nafsi wa ja'altuhu muharraman baynakum fala tadhlam. O my slave, I have made dhulm to be haram upon myself. No one made the dhulm haram upon Allah except for Allah himself. He said, no dhulm. I can't make dhulm. So it's not right for you when you make supplication against a person who had made dhulm upon you. Oh Lord, make dhulm upon him just like he made dhulm upon me. How can you do that? Allah made haram to make dhulm to anyone. So how can you just ask, oh Lord, just like he made dhulm upon me, make dhulm upon him. That's not right. But you could just say, oh Lord, I want to seek vengeance. A vengeance, yes. I want to avenge and revenge. You could ask for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-muntaqim. You're asking, oh Lord, recompensate me with what I have struck with this injustice. And if the person sought supplication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to get himself justified, then Allah azza wa jal subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, لَأَنْصُرَنَّهَا وَلَوْ بَعْدَهِ, I will give victory and I will fulfill that supplication even if it was after a while. I will give it. So there is no barrier between the supplication of a person who is under oppression and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no barrier. Straight away goes to Allah. Prophet Allah said, ثَلَاثُ دَعَوَاتٍ مُسْتَجَبَاتٍ لَا شَكَّ فِيهِمْ. There is three supplications that Allah would fulfill and there is no doubt about that. Number one, the maghroom, when he supplicates against his zalim. Number two, the traveler. And number three, who is that? The father and the mother. They said the father. It's a translation of the parent, the wife, but it's actually the father and the mother if they supplicate against or for their sons, whether it's the son or a daughter. So those are the supplications. Madloom, there's no barrier between his supplication and Allah. The traveler, for himself, for others. For himself is more likely because he's asking. But we don't go, for example, to ask somebody who is under oppression, brother, can you make dua for me because your supplication is fulfilled? No, his supplication is fulfilled is the one to do with his injustice. Same thing with the traveler. The traveler is the one who supplicates for himself. But no harm to ask him to supplicate for others. And the other one, the third one, is the parents. So the parents, well, each one of you may say, oh, mashallah, adults are parents. I'm not going to ask you, because you're a parent, make a dua for me. No, it's to do with the son or the daughter. Whether it's for him or against him. And this dua of the parents, oh, you have to be careful. It will be fulfilled. Even if that supplication is unjust. And what more than the story that you need to know is what? It's your age. We talked about that story a number of times. So there's no need to repeat that story. But we know that that woman, she asked, did we talk about it last week? No. Did you remember it? No. Yeah. What is the story then? What is the hadith? I want to read the hadith. Do you remember what he said? Right. We will tell you. For verily, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in two hadiths which are narrated by Abu Hurairah. Abu Hurairah narrates for us, and I am very important because this is part of the dhulm. Narrates for us that three babies, yeah. He narrates for us, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, that is, three children spoke in the cradle. Three children, this is the Sahih Imam Muslim, was spoken in the cradle. Those are the three, spoke in the cradle. And the first one is Isa alayhi salam, son of Maryam. And he was a miracle, the way he was formed and the way he was born. The way he was formed, it was a miracle. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salam to Maryam and he asked, he said to her, I am the messenger of your Lord in order to give you a ghulam, a baby. And he blew into her garment and she got pregnant. I'm just cutting the story short. It's a really fascinating story. So she got pregnant. So this is the way he was formed. So it was a miracle. And now when he was born, also is a miracle. When he was born, then the postnatal blood came to Maryam She was next to the palm tree. And she said, "Oh Lord, I wish that I never had any babies from the time I was born to the time I was dead, because people now are going to call her a fornicator." But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calmed her down and he said to her through Jibreel alayhi salam that Allah is with you. So number one, huzzi bijud'in nakhla, shake the trunk of a palm tree. Don't know if you've seen of a palm tree or not. Palm tree, subhanallah, is very strong tree. This is the shajara which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that is the root of it is so firm. It is really firm. For you, as an ordinary man, to shake it is impossible. You need a truck to even just shake it a bit. A car. Even if you have a car at a speed of 200 miles an hour, you don't want to do anything to the palm tree. Nothing. So, to talk about a person to shake it, and a woman to shake it, and a woman in her situation where she's so weak, she's about to give birth, it's impossible. So she shook it and the days fell. Rutaban janiya, tusatat alayki, rutaban janiya. Rutab means the fresh date. Janiya means very nice. And the people who collect dates, they know that if the dates fell from the top to the ground, they are not good for consuming, they're not good for eating. They have to be collected in the top. If it fell from there, they will go into pieces. So that's another miracle. And as well, there is tahta kisariya, there is like a river behind. So there's lots of food, this is a miracle, and also this is the miracle of the miracles. When she took him to her people, and her people, you know, said to her, "Ma kana abuki ma'a sawin, wa ma kanat ummuki baghiya." Come on, Maryam, what have you done? Your father was not a bad man, nor your mother was a prostitute. Because usually mother prostitutes, they would produce children or prostitutes. It runs in the lineage. How can you bring the baby? That means it's an implicit statement that you are a fornicator. So all she did, just like what Juraij he had said to the boy, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ, she pointed to him. Soon as she pointed to him, I mean, I'm helpless to say anything, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he told her from the beginning, if anybody asks you about the pregnancy, إِنَّ نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا, say to them that I have vowed to Allah that I'm going to be fasting from talking. I can't talk to anybody. And the vow at that time has to be fulfilled. So she can't talk to anybody. Now, she has to talk. Because it's a crime. Where's the baby coming from? فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. As soon as she pointed to him, he spoke seven sentences. Seven sentences. In which there are miracles. One of them, وَبَرَّمْ بِوَالِدَتِي, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to be. That is, قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ, I am the slave of Allah. That's the first thing, is it? أَتَنِيَ الْكِتَابِ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا, I have been given the book. And also, I have been given the prophethood. Also, I have been commanded to pay the charity. Also, I've been commanded to make the salah. Also, I've been commanded to be righteous, huh? To my mother. This is the one which is the sixth statement, to be righteous to my mother. So the Prophet Isa was commanded to be righteous to his mother. And you guys, this is the hadith of Abu Huraira, the second one, where he said that the Prophet of Allah one day ascended the pulpit. And he said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. One of those Ameens that he was asked, why did you say Messenger of Ameen, Ameen? He said, the Jibreel came to me and he said to me, he who lives to see his parents or one of them, yet he does not secure himself a place in paradise, then may Allah distance him away from it's from paradise. It means may Allah dip him in the hellfire. Say Ameen. I said Ameen. So if your father and your mother are alive, what are you doing? if you're not really doing what you're doing to secure yourself a place in paradise. What are you doing? So don't leave it late till you said, oh, I lost them. And I didn't really do good enough to secure myself a place in paradise by being righteous to them. Juraij's story, which is Abu Huraira narrates, and remind me about the story of Abu Huraira himself. That is, he said three children spoke on the Quran. One of them, Isa. Second one, Juraij. That is Juraij. Juraij was a person who is from Bani Israel, worshipping man. Every father would like to have a son like him. Every mother, she would be appreciating and being as well grateful to Allah to have a son like him. He built himself a monastery, a hermitage, on top of the mountains. That's where the Sawami' is really high. You need to go on. So every time, he goes all the way until in the night, he goes home. All the way there to make work worshiping of Allah. He seclude himself. So one day, mother, she wants him. So she had to go all the way up. When she went inside the Sawma, the hermitage, the monastery, he was praying. So she called him. So he said, oh Lord, my prayer, or shall I respond? So he said, my prayer. Then the mother gone all the way down. Following day, she goes all the way up. She finds him again praying. Juraij, oh Lord, my prayer, shall I respond to my mother? So he said, my prayer. So continue. So she went all the way down. Third day, goes all the way up. She finds him again praying. Juraij, oh Lord, shall I continue my prayer? Shall I respond to my mother? So he said, I will just continue praying. Ignore the mother. Soon as he ignored her for the third time, that's when the mother decided to make her supplication. And that supplication is in itself ruthless, merciless. Supplication in your, you could say, logic is not really right. She said, verily, O Lord, not permit Juraij to die until he seizes the faces of the prostitutes. Now she said that while Juraij is listening. And he was praying. He was praying and he was listening. Now Juraij, in his logic as well, he would never think that Allah would fulfill such a supplication. How can it be? Draw up. I'm praying. Priority goes to Allah. So this mother of mine, she's got no priority. So I don't think Allah would fulfill her supplication. That's the logic of Juraij, definitely. Because if he felt that Allah would fulfill this, he would have just stopped his prayer. Oh mother, please forgive me. Nothing. She said that and she left. And his justification, Juraij, for his mother, that she should have known that I am praying. She should wait. That's his justification. That's why he didn't do anything. And I'm saying as well on behalf of the mother, all mothers would love to have a son like him, true or not. Person is all the time, not on PlayStation, not on Xbox. Mas mashallah ibadah. True or not, all parents would love to have a son like that. Mashallah ibadah ibadah. MashaAllah, what a son he is. But yet the mother, all of that gone away from their brains. Okay, all of the, and I believe that maybe the mothers, even if they made the supplication, maybe that mother, she did not really mean that supplication. But if she said it, it will take place. If she knew, the mother is a mother, that her son will be exposed to the death because of that supplication of hers, she would have never made it. Because at the end of the story, we know that he's almost going to be killed because of that. Or she asked that, oh Lord, to expose himself to that fitna. What does a fitna mean here? The woman. And not the woman, the prostitutes. To see a woman in itself is a fitna. But to see a prostitute, a woman in herself is a fitna, but a woman who's saying to you, come on, that's biggest fitna. Very hard for a person to resist, unless he's mashallah pious. That's the biggest fitna. So I would say that his mother, mashallah, is a faqiha. She chose the right supplication for him against him, but it is a merciless one. No justice in it. And I believe that the mother, she knew what was going to happen later on, she would have never chose that supplication as well. What happened now? That the Banu Israel, they started talking about it in ibadah. And this is coming with the envy now. People can be envied because of their ibadah. People can be envied because they're memorizing Quran. People can be envied because of what? They come into the masjid. People can be envied just because they come to the class. They can be envied for that. Hasan! Allahu musta'an. So, they're talking about his ibadah. So one of the prostitutes said, do you want me to go and make fitna to him? Stop him from his ibadah? Yeah, go ahead if you can. So she started going onto the path from his house to the monastery. Stayed, for him to look at her. And I'm pretty sure that she had made herself so attractive to him. But he was never bothered to show you the person when he is, mashallah, on the people prayer. He's not even bothered. She's doing what she's doing, he's not even bothered. Goes to the monastery. He ignored her. So she felt nothing, but she never given up. There was a man, there was a shepherd, who wanted to be a follower of Juraij. So he went to the monastery and he started as well worshipping along with him. So she said, if I can't do it with him, let me do it with the other one. The other one was not as strong in ibadah as Juraij. Juraij was an abbot. As soon as he saw her, what he did, he committed the fahisha, the fornication. She wants to complete the crime. She got pregnant. She could have got rather than the baby, but she wants to what? Do and fulfill what she had promised the people. Do you want me to get him? I'll get him for you. She couldn't get him for the first fitna. She wants to get him now in the second fitna, which is lying. First fitna, expose him to them. Now lying against him. As soon as she got pregnant and delivered the baby, in that time, any person committing fornication, having a baby from fornication, penalty is death. So, when she delivered the baby, she was brought and summoned before the king. Who is the responsible for this? She said, verily, Juraij. As soon as she said, well, Juraij, the king, Sahibu Sawma'a, the one who is in the hermitage, that means he's known to the people, known to the king. Well known person. The sheikh, so and so. Yes. So he said to the people, Ihdimu alayhi Sawma'a, to go and destroy this Sawma'a. I said, Subhanallah, alladhi la ilaha illahu. I'm pretty sure that woman's reputation had preceded her, and everybody knows that she's a prostitute. A judge judging before even listening to the other party, and not only that, believing somebody who is in comparison with their sort of credibility, I would say you cannot just go and believe a prostitute against one who is a worshipper. Straight away they said, go and demolish it. All these people, they went to demolish his sawma. They put it down, it was made of mud, easy. Those people, subhanAllah, followers of everything. BBC News comes to them, Al Jazeera News comes to them, they believe it straight away. No verification. Have you heard about this? And then they will send it. They send it with each other, with this social medium. No verification. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم نبأ من إذا جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبين. Who you will believe if you have come with a rebellious or a news from fasiq, rebellious, don't verify. And how? What more rebellious do you want than a prostitute? He's telling you something. Sooner they demolished him, they also dragged him with humiliation. Come. When he came, he saw her and he saw her colleagues as well, prostitutes. As soon as he saw them, he laughed. He smiled. Now he's smiling in a position where he's not supposed to be smiling. So the king, he said, are you the father of that child? He said, that child, let me pray. So he made wudu and the prayer was known at the time of Banu Israel. Because Musa alayhi salam, he said, that the prayer was imposed upon him, what? 50 prayers. And he tried the Banu Israel. So they had a prayer. Maybe it's not exactly as our prayer, but it has sujood, ruku, and everything. And it has what? Wudu. Made wudu, made prayer, and came to the child. He has no witnesses now. Now, I'm asking, when he made this wudu and the turaka, he made what? Communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, for him to come without a witness, he did not say, by Allah, I didn't do it, by so and so. You could just see the time. What time was, you know, I was all the time, my days there. How could it be that bringing in offensive evidence? And then I work like that. Now, with his all confidence, and I'm really, still, till now, I can't really, subhanAllah. He goes and asks the baby, and he knows it's a baby. He knows it's a baby, and he's not a prophet. But this is the confidence of the Arab. Lord, I don't have anybody to really help me except for the baby. He's asking the baby, who's your father? No one would believe a baby would talk. He would start, but he's not going to talk. He asked the baby, and the baby spoke. I mean, if there was a gap time-wise between the question and between the answer, the people would have laughed. What are you talking, asking a baby? But there was no gap. As soon as he asked, he said, the shepherd. And that word was enough. Those people that are now, please, barakat barokin, slacking him, soaking him, touching him. Baraka, you're a holy man, everything. MashaAllah. Turn from a criminal, now to a holy man. Straight away to the king, he says, should we build your sawma from gold? This is compensation now. How do we say compensation? You know, if you were there, yeah, well, not just the sawma, depression, you know, maybe for depression. Whiplash, heplash, liplash, diplash, everything, all lashes. All of that, please. No, no, no. And I want my sawma to be the gold, build it back as it was from mud. That's compensation for me. Allahu Akbar. And the king answered, I just want to ask you, why did you smile when you came? He said, I remembered the supplication of, that means he heard it, the supplication of my mother. Oh Lord, not to make Juraj to die until he seizes the faces of the prophet. And I saw them. Never seen them before in his life. When he saw them, he recognized that this is the fulfillment of the supplication of his mother. So if you are doing injustice to your mother, this is the result. And if you're doing injustice to anybody else, a'udhu billah, be careful. Just before you die. Or before that person, if you meet just injustice to him, he dies. Before that, fulfill your obligations. Make sure you are, alhamdulillah, nothing to do with oppression, lying against him. A'udhu billah. What the devil is our action? There's no such thing. Brother, how much money do you want from me? I will give it to you. Just forgive me. There's no such thing. Hasanat, that's the currency. Hasanat, you have no hasanat? Okay, give the sayyat, take from me, sins. Okay, that's what it is. Ada hasanat, even if he's a kafir. And there is no way for you to, you are a kafir, you're going to go to the hellfire. What do you want for the hasanat for? Why are you taking from the hasanat? You know, no, hasanat, well, at least we'll go to the hellfire at the bottom. Less fire, less heat. Yeah, kafir will not go and tell you that you are going to the hafar forever. Why you want the hasanat of mine? No, hasanat. You don't have hasanat, take from my sins, please. I'm talking about kufr. Put on you as well. Until you have nothing and you'll be dipped in the hellfire. Wallahi al-Ali al-Azim. I mean, I don't understand that person who is doing injustice to another person still do nothing. Before the brother dies, before you die, go on, brother. Go and pay back. Injustice, whether it is injustice physical or financial or spiritual or anything, go on, tahallal ya akhi, tahallal, make yourself halal. Man, lots of injustice these days, especially to the parents, shouting at them, sometimes hitting them, wal'iyadha billah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, what is this person is doing? Right, and Abu Huraira, just reminded myself, Abu Huraira's story himself, radiallahu anhu, he had a Christian mother. When he embraced Islam, never given up with his Christian mother. Never given up to live with his Christian mother. never given up to stay with his Christian mother, even she used to insult the Prophet. So it's not just Christian, she's Christian plus. Christian as in religion, but plus that she was what? She's an enemy to the Prophet. She was insulting the Prophet of Allah. He never given up on her. The last thing that he did, he went to the Prophet of Allah. Messenger of Allah, my mother, make supplication. This is the weapon that the people forget about. Supplication. Make a supplication, Prophet of Allah. And this is now a Prophet of Allah making a supplication. So as soon as he made the supplication, oh Lord, make the Iman lovable to the mother of Abu Huraira. Abu Huraira went back having this optimism that something's going to happen. But he never thought his mother going to completely change. Because imagine if somebody's insulting and suddenly he's believing in it. So when he went to the door, he saw the door locked. As soon as he wanted to open it, she said, on your pot, on your spot, don't move. I'm having a ghusl. He doesn't know why she's having a ghusl. So he comes in, she comes out, she said, come in. He came in, and she said, say to her, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah. I'm asking, who taught her to have a ghusl? You know that that person, when he wants to have, to embrace the deen of Islam, he has to what? The wash. This wash is not because he's got sweat. No, he could be just having a wash before he embraces Islam. This wash is a spiritual wash. But it's done physically. Who told her to be the wash? Do you know what it is? Fitrah. This is the nature. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in us. Al-fitrah. And even the Prophet he called the amana ghuslul janaba. She made a fitrah. Her fitrah, she made a ghusl. And as soon as she went, shall Allah ilaha illa Allah. Now when your mother, the one that used to insult the Prophet of Allah, said this, what is your response? You jump up and down. You are in extreme joy. He left her straight to the Prophet ﷺ because he wants to give glad tidings to the one who was the reason for his mother to embrace Islam. Messenger of Allah, you know my mother, remember, you know, you don't want your lover to go to the hellfire while you go to paradise, do you? The most beloved person to you, Abu Huraira, wasn't married. So he didn't have a child called Huraira. Huraira is a cat, kitten. So his best person to him is whom? His mother. He loves her so much. His father died a long time ago. So his mother, he wants her. So she's with him. So, Prophet of Allah. Now he's not, because the dua was fulfilled, he wants another dua. Messenger of Allah. Call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us dear to the hearts of the believers. That's what something, you know, preoccupies the mind of Abu Huraira. Me and my mother. So Lord, make Abu Huraira and his mother to be the most beloved people to the hearts, or dear to the hearts of the believers, and make as well the believers to be as well as dear to the hearts of Abu Huraira and the mother of Abu Huraira. So Abu Huraira, he says, he boasts, no one who is a believer, he was born, was created, except that he would love Abu Huraira and his mother. So if you don't love Abu Huraira and his mother, you're not a believer. And he said, oh Lord, forgive for Abu Huraira and the mother of Abu Huraira, and forgive for the one who seek forgiveness for the father of Abu Huraira and the mother of Abu Huraira. Oh Lord, we seek forgiveness for Abu Huraira and the mother of Abu Huraira. Be included in the dua of Abu Huraira. Because he goes, oh Lord, seek forgiveness for the one who makes dua for me and my mother. So, and they are in Jannah, because they are companions anyway. They are in Jannah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had said, السابقون الأول من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوا رضي الله عنهم. And Allah, if He's pleased with them, it means in the Jannah. Coming back. The mother, if we're not talking about the mother, it's Allah. Coming back to Muhammad ibn Maslamah, because this is Muhammad ibn Maslamah رضي الله عنه, we're talking about Muhammad ibn Maslamah رضي الله عنه وارضاه. When we talk about Muhammad ibn Maslamah, the first thing that comes to our mind is the killing. Very good. The assassination. The assassination that took place is to a person called Ka'ab ibn al-Ashraf. He is a war criminal. He's not a Jew. He was a war criminal because we had Jews living in the Medina and they had transaction with the Prophet died, and his, you remember, his shield was pawned with a Jewish man. So no problem. But this Jewish man is what? War criminal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described those, the ones like him, the ones who are لَتَجِدَنَّ أَشَدَّ النَّاسِ عَدَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الْيَهُودِ وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَفُوا. Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, he was from the ones who hated Islam so much. So much that he couldn't believe that the Muslims had defeated the Quraysh in the Battle of Badr. He said, those defeated the people of Quraysh who are the kings of the Arabs, wallahi, it's better for me to live underneath the land, not on top of the land. He said, it's shame for me to be on top of the land where those ragtag, those nothing, have defeated the kings of the people. He couldn't believe it. And that is why as soon as this happened, straight away, where does he go? He goes to Mecca. What he does? He provokes them. And he starts weeping. Well, he's a poet, by the way. He was rich, he was beautiful, and he was a poet. So when you have these three things, you know, famous, poet, and rich, and beautiful. So it's war criminal in all of that, in the sense of all of these things. When he went there, he started now making poetry in order to bring the emotions back of those people who died in the Battle of Badr. So he had was the reason for the Battle of Uhud. He was the reason of the Battle of Uhud. So we find that as soon as he went there, the Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu arda, Abu Sufyan met him and he asked him, Ka'b, which one is better? Our religion or the religion of Muhammad? What did he say? Verily, the religion of yours. What is the religion of yours? Idolatry is better than the religion of Muhammad. And you are more guided than Muhammad. Look at that war criminal. He's from the people of the book. And he knows that those idolaters are kuffar and mushrikeen. And he talks about the monotheistic, which are the Muslims. Their religion is nothing compared with the religion of the idolaters. And that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals in Surah An-Nisa, verse 51-52. Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَ, can't you see, إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, to the ones who are given portion of the book, and he meant Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْجِبْتِ وَالطَّهُ, they're believing in the kufr, وَيَقُولُونَ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, and they would say to the people who are disbelievers, هَؤُلَاءِ أَهْدَى, those are more guided than مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا سَبِيلًا, from the ones who have been believed, so they are more guided than them. So you, the idolaters, the worship of the kufr, better than the ones who are monotheistic. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ. Allah, those are the people whom Allah had cursed. وَمَنْ يَلْعَنِ اللَّهُ, and whom Allah curses, فَلَنْ تَجِدَ لَهُ نَصِيرًا, you will not find a helper towards him. Ka'b ibn Ashraf, he was making poetry, even against the wives of the Prophet of Allah, against the wives of the companions. So he was talking about the honor. And the honor with the Arabs, you are playing with your blood. If you speak about the honor of someone, that means you are talking about death. Can't talk about the wife of someone, or the sister of someone, or the daughter of someone, because you are accusing them of something which is to do with fornication. And when you have fornication, that means the lineage of yours is not right. You know your lineage. And when your lineage is not right, that means the whole society has been corrupted. And when you are speaking about the lineage of someone that's not to be true, then you are actually asking for death. This is the death penalty. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as soon as he had seen this man, he had reached the limit, or he exceeded the limit, he said, "Man li bi Ka'b?" Who is gonna assassinate Ka'b for me? Right. Muhammad ibn Maslama is our companion. He said, Messenger of Allah, do you want me to kill him? He said to him, yes. He said, then give me permission to say something. And this is from the etiquette of this companion. Give me permission to say something that means against you. That means I have to pretend that I'm a kafir. And in order to pretend I'm a kafir, I have to say something against you yourself. That means that you are a bad man. Because if you say that about the Prophet of Allah, it's kufr. It's major kufr. You're outside the fold of Islam. But Messenger of Allah, give me permission to do kufr. Give me permission to what? To make kufr. But this kufr, with this heart is what? Full of iman. When the heart is full of iman, and you made this kufr for a maslaha shar'iyya, no problem. So if, for example, that some of the Muslims were stranded or were imprisoned in one of those temples that belonged to an X or Z or Y religion, and for you to go and help them, you need to put the symbol of kufr on you in order to pretend that you are from them in order to help those people, is no problem. Do you understand that? But this is something to do with that you are immune against. So when you said the word against the Prophet of Allah, you're not going to follow up and be a kafir. So you're immunized against it. So there's no such thing that you are allowed to do something that you might end up doing it later on. What do I mean by this? So if, for example, the Muslims are stranded in a place where there are people who are womanizing, men and women and everything. So you can't just say to the leader, give me permission to fornicate with one of them in order to pretend I'm like them, and then I'll help those Muslims being locked up there. Can you do that? No. Give me permission to drink some wine or alcohol, to pretend I'm with them and to help them. That's not right, because who's going to guarantee that you're not going to pull out from this? Pull out from the fornication or pull out from the drinking the alcohol, because this is to do with the lust. The other one is not lust. So give me permission, Messenger of Allah, to give. He said, yes, you have the permission. And this permission is not for Muhammad Maslama, permission for anybody. As long as the commander has said to him, yes, because the maslaha is there. The maslaha is there. So Ka'b ibn Ashraf, now he is in his citadel, fortress. And Muhammad Maslama goes and pays him a visit. And he says to him, you know this man, and he meant the Prophet, you know that man, he actually had overburdened us with lots of tax. You know, verily, Ka'b ibn Ashraf, he said, yeah, and he was really happy. I think you're going to get bored of this man. Ka'b ibn Ashraf, he said, yeah, well, we followed him. We don't want to back off from that until we see what is the end of this man. So just give me, let me borrow, you know, whisk, which is the about 60 sa' whisk. Give me that in order, some barley, in order to give, you know, the tax to this man until we see what we're going to do with him. Now, even that, Ka'b ibn Ashraf, Muhammad Aslama to him, he is a foster brother. Foster, and from the same mother. Even that, Muhammad Maslama, he is on the same path, or pretend to be on the same path as this man. Even though he said to him something that really made Ka'b ibn Ashraf so happy, you would have expected that this Ka'b ibn Ashraf would give Muhammad Maslama those barley with no return. If there's a return, at least we'll take them and then whenever you have money, bring them back. Could have said that. But he said, no. Okay, I'll give you, but what are you gonna give me in guarantee? What is that thing that you're gonna give me in order for me to pawn until you bring it back? Subhanallah. You are his foster brother. Plus, he is this man shouting, telling you that, oh, yeah, I'm on the same path as you are. At least you could have just said you don't have this until you have money. Bring it back. He said, no. In case you don't pay, give me something. He said, what? So give me your wife. He said, I'm going to give you my wife. And you are the most beautiful in the Arabs. I can't guarantee. Then what's going to happen to my wife? And by the way, before we let, he said, not wife, because it was, as well, Muhammad said, he said, by the way, there are other people like me. Same thing. They're gonna, but they have to give them as well value. said, okay, what are you going to give me in return, just to make sure? He said, your wives. I'm going to give you a wife because you're the most beautiful of Allah. Okay, give me your children. To pawn them. We're not going to give you our children. Imagine you're going to give you our children for the sake of Bali and they're going to be bullied for the rest of their life. You've been pwned for the sake of Bali. We're going to accept that. So we're going to give me them. Well, we'll give you our weapon. The weapon costs a lot of money. Weapon. He liked that. And actually, Muhammad Samis was a plan to bring the weapon that he would not suspect they're going to come to kill him. Okay, weapon the weapon. Accept it. And they made a date. That night, they came, him and his companions. And Muhammad Samah, he had planned everything. He said to them, "I'm going to come down. As soon as I'm really getting hold of him, I will tell you to go and kill him." So he went inside. As soon as he went inside, there were lots of metals with him because, you know, weapons. So he got up and his wife, she said, "I could hear the sound of blood." I could, subhanAllah, she says, "I could hear the sound of blood." She said, no, don't worry. He's my foster brother. Along with him, some people, they already got bored of this man. It means Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, as soon as he went down from his fortress, he had perfume. Ooh, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very nice perfume. What is that? Abu Na'ila, his kunya, another person. Oh, mashallah, what nice perfume. He said, "Yes, I am the most beautiful, and I've got the most beautiful woman, and I've got the most beautiful perfume. Most beautiful in his face, got most beautiful wife, and he's got the most beautiful as well, perfume." "Okay, Mark, can I just smell it?" So he put his hand on his head. Nice, right. Now he made him to relax. And after a while, "I can't resist. Can I just smell again?" So he gave him his head, he held it. "Dunakum. Do it." And it's finished. As soon as he's finished, he made a crab, an awful shout, scream, cry, ooh, or something. All the Jews in there had heard this. And all of them heard it and they didn't know anything. They just put their lights on, the torches on, or the candles on, and then after that they locked everything till the morning. Like, I'm not bothered. Didn't bother about what's happening. In the following day, they found out that he was what? Assassinated. They told everybody. Muhammad Rasim and his companions went already to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they have fulfilled their mission. This is Muhammad ibn Maslamah radiallahu anhu wa arda. So when we remember Muhammad ibn Maslamah, we remember the Ansar. And we know for the fact, those Ansar are the ones that showed courage. First of all, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the one from Allah Azza wa Jalla giving them the name the Ansar. So nobody had named the Ansar except for Allah the Almighty. A man said to Anas, "You know this name Ansar, because you're Aus and Khazraj. Is it something that you've been naming yourself with, or is it Allah had named you with?" He said, "No, Allah named us the Ansar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has said, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ." So Al-Ansar, those are the ones who gave help. Ansar bin Nasr gave help. So they gave help to the migrants or the immigrants. Also the Prophet ﷺ, he all the time, he would praise the Ansar. For he said, one of the signs of the Iman is to love the Ansar. And the signs of hypocrisy, to hate the Ansar. Al-Ansar, nobody would love them except for a believer. Nobody would hate them except for a munafiq, hypocrite. And he who loves them, Allah would love him. And he who hates them, Allah would hate him. The Ansar, the most beloved people to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Messenger of Allah, he was saying, "By the one in whose hand in my soul, I would like, for better, you are the most beloved people to me. And had it been for the migration, for the hijrah, I would have chosen to be from the Ansar. And if the people chose a path, and you, Ansar, chose another path, I would choose the path of the Ansar." Subhanallah. "O Lord, forgive for the Ansar, and forgive for the children of the Ansar." So Ansar, those are the ones, if you remember, Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, Sa'd ibn Ubadah, when the Prophet of Allah is about to start the battle of Badr, and he was asking, confirming with his companions, "What should we do? Should we fight or not?" And remember, the first covenant with them is that not to fight except in the Medina, but outside the Medina, there is no covenant for that. So he said, "Shiru Ali, come on, give me consultation." So the Al-Miqdad spoke, Abu Bakr spoke, Umar spoke, but he was Shiru Ali. He doesn't want the Muhajirun because he knows the Muhajirun, he knows the Ansar. Oh, you mean us, Messenger of Allah? He said, yes, I mean you. I mean the Ansar. The Aus of Khazraj. What do you think? The Messenger of Allah, we believe in you and we followed you. And we gave you the protection to protect you just like we protect ourselves and our wives and our children. Messenger of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might show you something good from us because we are the people of war. Oh Messenger of Allah, if you to be plunged, the sea will plunge along with you. If you go to plunge the sea, we will plunge along with you. لَوْ خُطَّ الْبَحْرَ لَخُطْنَاهُ مَعَكْ. Those are the companions, رضي الله عنهم وارضاه, from the Ansar. Now, after this, we learn from the following. We learn from the story of the Muhammad ibn Maslamah is that not to take the story of the killing of Ka'b ibn Ashraf, that is to be an alibi for you to go and assassinate. The assassination at that time, number one, was done by the leader of the country, the Prophet of Allah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number two, that assassination had been done with in a way that will not entail mafsada. Do you understand that? There will not be a mafsada more than the maslaha they're trying to do. So the disadvantages are not there. So he had killed him and he went back to Medina. And he was saying, I killed him. Do you understand that? So it's not, he killed him and then he went within the Muslims, he hid himself. And then the enemy would come and kill everybody. Huh? The righteous and not the righteous, the old and the old, the soldier and the soldier. That's not right. So there's no mafsada. So for those people who are taking this as a story for assassination, that's not right. We find that the narration talks about Muhammad ibn Maslamah that he died in the year 46 after Hijrah. And he was 77 years old. He is one of the people who had lived in Medina and then he's lived in Al-Rabada. Al-Rabada is in Bilad al-Sham. Al-Rabada is in Bilad al-Sham. And the way he died is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ had said. When he said to him, take my sword and fight with it, the kuffar. And if there is a fitna between the Muslims, then bring that sword and stay at home until somebody will come, give you the fatal blow. A man from Bilad al-Sham, from the Jordan, from Ahl al-Urdun, he went in his house and he gave him the fatal blow and he killed him. So Muhammad ibn Maslamah radiallahu anhu, he's like the other companions, like Abu Bakr and others, who did not participate in that fitna. And he's the ones who narrated the hadith regarding the fitna. He said, if this man comes to you and on you, they want to kill you. And if you are scared of the shining or the reflection of the sword, then cover your face. Let him take the sin of you killing you. Don't ever kill a Muslim. Because if you do so, then you are on the day of resurrection. I'm not saying this, oh, that means you could kill a non-Muslim. I'm just saying what is happening in our country is Muslim killing Muslims for the justification of what? What is their justification for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That fitna that took place. When there is a fitna, you go away from it. But the fitna is Muslims killing Muslims. Okay? When there is called baghi, but not kharuj. You understand the word? So if there is a leader in the country settled to, regardless if it's time or not time, there's people making kharuj on him. You know what's a kharuj? They can takfir upon the Muslims. Then you fight along with what? With the leader. You fight with whom? That's not to do with the fitna. The fitna was with Ali, Muawiyah. Fitna. Ali radiallahu anhu and Aisha radiallahu anhu. Fitna. Muslim with Muslim. But this one, Khawarij. After the leader was having the country been settled to him, even as a tyrant, these people that come under revolt against him. So what do? We fight along like Imam Ahmad. He fought along. Al-Ma'mun, Al-Wafiq, المعتصم. All of those who had said القرآن مخلوق كفر. And he said قتال الخوارج أولى من قتال الأعداء. To fight those people who are making the revulsion against the leader is more of a priority than fighting the outside enemy. Look at that. Look at the fiqh of Imam Ahmad. Now this Imam Ahmad, was a government scum? Did he receive a salary? I'll tell you what he received. Prison, lashing, dislocation of his joint, he pulled. You know, humiliated, that he really received. But still he said, we'll fight along with those whom is lashing me, imprisoning me, I will fight along with him. Sheikh Salman Taymiyyah, he said, for verily, fighting the enemies is a profit. And fighting the Khawarij is reserving the capital. And you will never have a profit until you have your capital safe. Do you understand that? If you have your capital safe, then you'll be able to fight the enemies which are the prophet. In order for you to defeat your outside enemy, you have to defeat your internal enemy. Khawarij. Khawarij. A'udhu billah. They have made khuruj. The first made khuruj, khuruj al-fikri wal-i'tiqad. Khuruj in their ideologies. Then after that, they made the khuruj al-musallaha. Killing. In the name of what? In the name of what? Allahu musta'an. We stop here, inshallah. And I've gathered my information from mainly from Al-Isaba to Ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah, and also from the book of Al-Sahaba, Sheikh Taha Abu Islam. Now, repeat the question, please.
So, if we are advised never to kill Muslims,
no.
And Allah says to kill the Khawarij is the best to kill under the sky,
yeah.
How do them to apply?
Is it, how do they apply? The question for the sisters as well. We say that how can it be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He prevented us from killing the Muslim, but yet in the hadith says that killing the Khawarij is like the best thing to do? Well, first of all, this can be answered in two ways. Number one, this is what Imam Ahmad's proof, that the Khawarij is what? Not Muslims. They're not Muslim for him. Other scholars say he's Muslim. The second proof, let's say they are Muslims. What Allah says. وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اَقْتَتَلِ. It's not the Khawarij. Two groups of Muslims are fighting on another. فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Rectify. After the islah, فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى. If one transgressor than the other one, فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي. Fight the one who was what? Making baghi. And when we fight the one who was making baghi, حَتَّى تَفِيَا إِلَى أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. To go back to the what? The commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we fight it and we might kill in order to what? To save the majority. We kill few to save the majority. And when we fight the Khawarij or we fight the Mughal, there is no such thing that if there is a person who is injured, to A, continue killing him. Or there is no such thing, if there are women, to take them as war booty. There's no war booty for that, because Muslim is Muslim. So all this killing is actually to bring back the settlement, bring back the safety. So we say that, like for example, what make you to, it's like the example, the parable that our sheikhs to give, why we make this killing. It's like a nail being pushed into the wall. Okay? So, the wall asking the nail, why are you breaking me, penetrating me? He said, don't ask me, ask the one who's hitting me. Ask the one hammering me. Why are you asking? I mean, I have no choice. It's the same thing, we have no choice here. We have to fight these people. So why do we do this? It's because, in other words, why are you already seeking this bad medicine, which is bad taste? Because we want to cure ourselves. So this is a result of Those people, we can't really, that is why, first of all, that's why in the Khawarij, we have to debate with them. We don't fight straight away. I don't know, we had what? Debate with them. But at the end, still they want to fight. And Ali said, I will not fight them until they what? Fight me. When they started the fight, he fought them. So when you have a Khawarij next to you, they're not telling you, go and kill him, brother. No. It's not for you to kill him. We're going to debate with him and talk to him. But he still, I will raise his matter to the authority. This man is a bad cancer. If I don't really locate that cancer and isolate him, it will spread. And those Khawarij who are Pa'adi, the ones who are Khawarij, but they are on the table, they are worse than the Khawarij who are in the ground. On the table, they're worse. Because they're the ones who are manufacturers of Khawarij. Yeah? Like a masna. Manufacture Khawarij. They produce them on the field. They be killed, bring and produce another one. Like mafram, mashallah alayhum. Farrama.
Fadda. Can you be a khawarij if you don't make takfir by sins?
Can I make khawarij? Can I be khawarij by not making takfir? Yeah. Can a person be a khawarij without making takfir? The takfir of the khawarij is a result of something they've done before. So the takfir is not a condition for being a khawarij. Now, you know that Aisha radiallahu anha, she made khuruj against Ali ibn Abi Talib. And she said it herself, radiallahu anha. She said to Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, why didn't you prevent me when I left and I made khuruj? Why didn't you prevent me? That I saw two people on top of him. Two people, that means they are telling you and I can't do anything. They are older than me. Talha and Zubayr. She said, and she had regretted what she had done, that she said that there's a space for her in that room with Abu Bakr and Umar and the Prophet ﷺ is the first. But she kept it for herself to die there. She said, I don't deserve to be buried there. Because of that thing that she has done, she felt, I felt that. She reserved a plane, she said, no, take me to the Baqi'a now, and bury me there. So she is to cry until her veil is totally wet, because of what she has done. And she regretted, she wanted to go back. But Talha al-Zubayr radiallahu anhu convinced her, you are the mother believers, when they see the people will come to you and will have mashallah one group and everything. She wanted to go back. As soon as she heard the dogs of the Hawa, dogs of the Hawa from the tribal place called Kilab al-Hawa. When they barked, she said, what is these dogs? She said, Kilab al-Hawa. She said, oh, I remember the Prophet, he said, Ayyatukun, who is amongst you from the words of the Prophet of Allah, whom the dogs of Hawa will bark against? Well, verily, she is the one going to be people killing, being killed around her camel. And exactly what the Prophet of Allah said, exactly what happened. So she don't go back. Subhanallah. But that is when you have some people with you and telling you, sometimes you can't really take your choice. So she had felt that. So the question is, can he be a khawarij? Yes, you can. Al khuruj al fikri, when you are ideology wise, to make khuruj is that later on it will lead to the takfir. And the takfir is as well in scale. Some people make takfir with, you know, any sin, which is the ultimate, but some think, no, if you just say that, hey, the ruler does not rule by the book of Allah, is a kafir. But they go, those are the ones further and further until they reach any sin, you're a kafir. So, those people, like Al-Hasan, Al-Hasan ibn Salih, Al-Hayy, Al-Hayyum Hassan ibn Salih. He's a narrator. Subhanallah. His name is from the Muhaddithin. Al-Hassan ibn Salih. He is from the Muhaddithin whom Imam Ahmad, he said, wari' thiqa, masha'Allah. But the Imam Sufyan al-Thawri used to say regarding him, is a person used to see the sword. What does it mean, the sword? That means, that is, he says that not to pray the Jumu'ah behind those leaders. Not to pray the Eid prayers behind those leaders. Because they are leaders, they lead by other than the ways of Allah. They are Muslims, but they too some of those. So, Karayah Saif. So the Khawarij is not a takfir, is that they used to see the what? The sword. And before they made the sword, they made khuruj in their ideologies. They see the sword. And Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, as soon as he saw Hasan al-Musalih when he was coming to the Jumu'ah, coming to the prayer, and he was going to put his shoes, and he came from the Bab al-Sharqi door, he saw him, he said, A'udhu billahi min khushu'i munafiqi. I seek refuge from the submissiveness, the khushu' of the hypocrites. He called him a hypocrite, even though he is a muhaddith. He is great muhaddith. He is thiqa, according to the scholars. Hasan ibn Salih, very great scholar. So he left that and he went to another door. He said, I don't want this munafiqeen. And when he died, and his janazah was in the middle, when the imam is about to pray on it, Sufyan al-Thawri is well known to everybody. He came, washaqqa as-sufuf, in front of everyone. And he went to look at him, like this. And then he left, so that people can see him leaving. And he did not pray upon him. He's not, he didn't say that praying upon him is haram, but remember, any person who Ahl al-Bid'ah, that the people who are known to be from Ahl the Sunnah, they should not pray. So the Imam should not pray upon him. People who are knowledgeable people, they're known, should not pray upon him. So that the people will see, oh, why didn't you pray upon him? Because he's Ahl al-Bid'ah. So Ahl al-Bid'ah would say, oh, I don't want to be Ahl al-Bid'ah because those people, we're not going to pray on my janazah. So it will be deterrence for them. So yes, there is Khawarij, it could be called Khawarij even. And the Khawarij, as I said, they are different from their, how much Khawarij they are. The Takfir is one of the things that they will reach to it. Now, Jazakallah khair. Tafadhal. This is Hudayth ibn al-Yaman, not the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's not authentic from the Prophet, he's authentic from Hudayth ibn al-Yaman. Does it say Hudayth ibn al-Yaman? Okay, but Hudayth ibn al-Yaman. Okay, Allah's Messenger. I don't think that the hadith marfu' is to be sahih. But let me just check as well. No, the marfu'. He says, yes, I've heard the Prophet, yes, correct. I think authentic by Sheikh al-Bani. He said, I've heard the Prophet, he said, لا تضرك الفتنة. He will not be exposed to Allah. No. Hudhayfa and the Prophet according to the Isabah, he did not mention the Prophet of Allah, but here I find it, yes, that he said, I don't really fear anybody against the fitna regarding Muhammad Rasulullah. Verily I've heard the Prophet of Allah saying, La tadurruk al-fitna, fitna will not affect you. And when the fitna took place, he isolated himself from it. Now, inshallah. Father, uncle. I want you to repeat, uncle, the question because I was not concerned. I was looking at that narration. Go ahead, again, uncle. So somebody had offended lots of people. I mean, that brother, he had repented to Allah, but now that person who was, he done injustice to him, it's too late for him because he died. Okay. So, yes, he could ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect him on the day of resurrection against that dhulm that he's done. And on the day of resurrection, that man would ask for his injustice to be justified. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would pay on his behalf. So if that man who repented properly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would protect him because he repented to Allah azza wa jal, and he wanted, he would have wished that that man, but what I'm just saying, you don't want to be in such a situation. So if your person plans like this, let me do injustice to him, even if he doesn't die, it doesn't matter because I repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then Allah will protect me. We don't, this is, it's not, can be, cannot be pre-planned like this. But a person who's done dhulm and he suddenly wanted to repent to Allah, and he asked, where is that person? He told him that he died. His repentance and his remorse would show that if he's sincere or not, how how it's going to reflect on him. You know, he's going to be in agonization all the time. I don't know what's going to happen to me. I don't know if that man is going to, you know, forgive me. I don't know. Okay? Now. So it's a better for the person, if somebody done injustice to him, that to say, oh Lord, if that man has done justice to me, that if he repented to you, oh Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am forgiven. Now. No, there are more than three babies who are in the cradle. You've got about five babies who are in the cradle. But this is the hadith says, three babies who are in the cradle. The hadith says, but we know more than that. The Ghulam Ukhdud, Surah Al-Buruj, is one who had spoken the cradle. It's not mentioned in that story. So we have more than one spoken the cradle. Now, Fadal. So what is the punishment of a judge? A judge who is forcing a witness or someone to write a false statement. First of all, let's talk about the person who's going to write that. How much was the force that he was enforced to do that? What is the outcome if that person refused to write it? If the outcome is so jeopardizing that he had to do it, and if it's not involving somebody else, then he could do it. But if it's involving somebody else, and he could bear the consequences, even though it's going to be great, he could bear the consequences, then he should not lie. But if it's to do with life and death, he could. You know. As for the judge, Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Qudatu Thalatha. Three judges, you choose. Two are in the hellfire. And one is in paradise. Two in the hellfire are the ones who are either they have known the haqq, did not judge with it, or they knew the haqq and it's worse and judged in the battle. Both of them in the hellfire. Third one is in paradise, the one who knows the haqq and he implemented the haqq. Do you understand what I'm saying? No? Okay, I'm not going to repeat it again, I'm going to just say to the people who did not say I didn't understand, to repeat it again. Ya Shakir, repeat what I said.
Two judges in the hellfire, one in the paradise.
Tell me the ones in the hellfire.
One in the hellfire, the one who doesn't know the haqq and makes him believe. And the second one, the one who knows the truth and goes against it.
Do you understand that? Okay. The first one, he knows the truth and he did not implement it. Second one, he knows the truth and he does not. He implements the other way. So he knows the haqq and he does not rule in it. The one who is jahil about the haqq is different. But he knows the haqq, but he does not rule in the favor of that. Another one who knows the haqq and he rules opposite. A'udhu billah. Wallahu a'lam. And this is the three judges. And regarding your person, he is a'udhu billah. I don't understand how can a person, a judge, could force someone to write something. Usually it is the police would do that, not the judge. I mean, the police in countries which are corrupted, they would force the witness to write something, okay? They would force them, corrupt country, they'll do that. And the judges should be saving and looking for the haqq. Can you check the hadith for me, please, with the judges as well, just to make sure that maybe I got it for the other version, right? Correct. Just check it for me. Now. The question is that if the person does not love the people of Medina now, are the people of Medina now called the Ansar? Okay. If this person believes that the people of Medina are still Ansar, then still that is applied. But if the person he's talking about the Ahl Medina, that the people who are mixing up, and you know, they could be from China, they're Ahl Medina as well. Okay? So, no, the Ahl Medina is not the Ahl Ansar. Because Ahl Medina at that time, they used to get with the Jews, with the, you know, they're not the Ahl Medina as well. So in Prophet, he had specified the Ansar. And he specified the Ansar, that those the Ansar, who are Ansar at that time, Okay? He did not specify the ones who are going to come later on live in the Medina. He did not specify, he specified as well the sons of the Ansar. Because they're from the Ansar. But the ones who are sons and stays upon Islam. But if you're a son, you're a kuffar, you should hate him. For the sake of Allah. Even from the Ansar. Now, so the Ansar is not a tribe, by the way. Ansar is given, they're given aid to the immigrants. Father,
here. So the question is about etiquette in graveyard. After burial, dua for the person, dua for the deceased, or dua for the person who is making the dua for himself. What is the etiquette? Individual or congregational? And waiting for until the next salah in the graveyard.
Do you think it for dua, you mean?
After burial.
You mean a father had died or a mother had died, what is the etiquette of a son or a daughter?
After burial in the graveyard.
In the graveyard, what is the etiquette? Well, the etiquette of the graveyard is it's not really an etiquette which is compulsory. An etiquette which is, you know, recommended. Which is by the children and the other than the children. Which is that to stay next to the grave. بِقَدْرِ مَا تُنْحَرُ الْجَزُورُ وَيُوَزَّعُ لَحْمُهَا to the time of the slaughtering of a camel and the meat to be distributed, which we call it in our about half an hour, 20 minutes. To stay there because it will give like company for the person who is dead. يَأْنَسُ بِهِ. So this is an etiquette which is good, especially to the parents, but it's not compulsory. It's not compulsory. In the graveyard, they should not be receiving condolences of the people. I think you're right with the hadith. And the judge, they said, coming to the judges, the judge who does not know the haqq, and the judge who knows the haqq and did not implement it, and the judge who knows, so the judge as well, the one in Jannah, the one who knows the haqq and implemented. Now, making dua for yourself in the graveyard? What does that mean? You mean you as a person who's alive?
Yes, forgive me as well, forgive the deceased.
You mean when you are making to the dua to the deceased, you're including yourself? If that is just like being done like that, but it's not to specify that you need to make dua, or it's more of responded to, if you make dua to yourself in the graveyard, then it's really accepted. But if you think there is more of acceptance to make dua to yourself in the grave, that's not right. This is where we come, where we say that this is where the shirk came from. People used to get to the graveyard and make rituals there, which are not from the sunnah. One of them is to start making ibadah. They start with making dua in a place where the Prophet does not specify. Making dua there for themselves, not for that, but for the graves. And then after that, they could make rituals. Like for example, i'tikaf, seclusion there. Then after that, they could make prayers, not to the grave, but prayers to Allah, next in the graveyard, where a prohibition is being imposed there, because there's no prayer in the graveyard, except for the prayer of the janazah. And then after that, it will go along to worship in the grave. That's how it happened. By the way, worshipping the graves is the one or the ibadah that actually drifted away most of the religion to the idolatry. They started with this, the grave, the dead person, and what rotates and revolves around this sort of, you could say, ghaib thing. People, they are fascinated with things they don't know about, so they think the person who's in the grave, he has such power that goes to the life. That's what they think, out of ignorance. And this is actually being taken from the philosophy from those people before us. A long time ago, the pharaohs and the Greeks. The pharaohs, you know what they do? They built pyramids upon whom are those kings who died. And they put the treasures and everything. And they make mummies. Why do they make the mummies? They want to preserve the body of that person in order to be preserves the other life. They believe there's another life. Okay, they put jewels, they put a torch as well. They believe that that other life is dark, it needs a torch. They believe that that other life, it needs beauty, so they have to beautify themselves. So that is why the grave robbers, you know, they're very good in this. They like those people who are worshipping these things, because they want to rob them. Have you heard about grave robbers? In Brazil, they have one. You know, because a Christian, they bury the person with what? His jewels, you know that? So the grave robbers, so now the Christians, they have to either employ people to protect them or to bury them without the rituals. And I have been sent, this is the last thing I'm going to talk about. I've been sent an email about a Christian Lebanese. And you could check that. Christian Lebanese, whom she died in Lebanon, she asked in her will to be buried with her full bedroom. So they dug the ground and they put the whole of her bedroom, with the wardrobe, the clothes, and the shoes, and the bed, and she was on top of her bed. And the fascinating thing, even the alcohol drinks. You see it? You see it? Alcohol drinks. And the person who's digging it all, he's talking, got a cigarette in his mouth. Well, it doesn't matter anyway. There's no respect to the grave. So you got to bury it on top and then you're going to put that thing. So any person seeing this, it could be money, he has to rob the grave. He has to rob the grave. Well, I think the money is beneficial more to the alive than the dead. So, I mean, I could understand his logic. Okay. So anyway, such things happens when there is some things which are not from God in the religion. It can't be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يفعل من قد سمعنا وجزاكم الله خيرا